President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate, of the House of Representatives, yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. Indeed, 1 hour after Japanese air squadrons had commenced bombing in the American island of Oahu, the Japanese ambassador to the United States and his colleague delivered to our Secretary of State a formal reply to a recent American message. And while this reply stated that it seemed useless to continue the existing diplomatic negotiations, it contained no threat or hint of war or of armed attack.
Well, I'm Margaret Freeman now, but I was Margaret Stewart then, and hadn't been out of high school very long, of course, when the war broke out.
Good morning. This is Florence Moretti Rose. I was born and raised in Worcester. I graduated from Worcester High School in 1942. I also graduated from the Western Union School of Telegraphy in Crawfordsville, Indiana, in 1943.
Hey, I am Sue Armbruster, and I worked at the Firestone Tire and Rubber Company during World War II. I was Rosie the Riveter on a C-46 and a C-47.
My name is Mary Winner. I've lived in Barberton most of my life.
My name is Eileen, used to be Hedden Tench. When the war started, I remember that night very vividly. On December 7th, 1941, my father and I had gone to a movie, and we were on our way home, and it was snowing, and it was a cold night. It was a Sunday night, and we heard the announcement on the radio about Pearl Harbor.
When all this news broke out, why, President Roosevelt was the president then, and it was like, What happened? You know, all of a sudden, everybody is hearing this news on the radio. Well, nobody knew what to do. And then the first thing you know, it's the crash in Pearl Harbor. And then I guess maybe your grandfathers or fathers, mothers, or somebody has told you about the Pearl Harbor accident. And when the Japs came over, and all of our friends volunteered to go to the service, and most of them, the ladies right away, and the people that could went to work at the Goodyear aircraft, the Firestone, the Cyberlin, and they made different things like lifeboats and all kinds of things during the war. And without the women working, I think we did a real good job. I really do.
My name is Betty Taylor, and I'm 85 years old. And I'm going to tell you about things that happened 65 years ago and more when I was Betty Curtis was my name then. I'd like to go a little bit before the war and give you some background. I graduated from high school in 1941. It was the last class that we afterwards called normal times before the war started. It was the last high school graduation. And people who graduated went for jobs or went to college and that kind of thing, the normal kinds of things you do. Well, of course, we all know that on December 7th, the whole world changed. I remember being at my cousin's house in a side room where we were just visiting, and there was a little radio up on a shelf there, and all of a sudden it said, the Japanese have bombed Pearl Harbor. And that changed the world. There's no question about that.
I couldn't believe it. Nobody could believe it. I mean, it was just like a disaster. It was something that didn't happen to the United States, but it did.
There's a garden, what a garden, only happy faces bloom there.
I was the first girl they hired, and I had been told by this person who wanted me to take the job, said, you can set the tone for what it will be like for others coming into the lab. And I think that you're maybe the one that can do that. I'm the one that decided what went on in that lab, and I ran a tight ship. You didn't swear, you didn't tell off-color stories, you didn't hang around. You came in and if you had business and then you got out again. And I think it worked well. The kind of an operation that was going on there was brass plating metal that was going to be used in making tank track. Now, to me, what happened in the United States when the war started was absolutely fabulous. Everybody pitched in. Everything was done. How they converted into wartime production and everything so quickly, I'll never know. This was 1 year later, and we were fully in production and had been for quite a long time.
I worked at Cyberling Rubber Company, and they had tanks, rubber tanks, about 12 to 14 feet long. They had a, a door, it might have been 20 by 14. Inches wide and high. We were to climb in there and repair tanks that may have had bubbles or imperfections. And we had a buffer, a light, and a small container of black adhesive cement.
Then they hear a rumble on the floor. It's a big surprise they're waiting for.
I had to go into training for 3 weeks, learn to be a riveter and drill. I drilled holes and all that sort of thing. And then I was sent over to Goodyear. And I worked in the air dock, the big building with the where they build the airships. And it was very interesting.
In the years before Pearl Harbor, the average American family consisted of a working father and a stay-at-home mother who raised the children. On December 7, 1941, the lives of all Americans would forever be changed. As men went off to war, someone had to take responsibility for the well-being of the country. This included women taking on jobs that men had previously done. Overall, women became the backbone of the American labor force.
In 1941, America entered into a war with Japan. This war was spurred on by the attack on the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor by the Japanese. The Japanese intended to prevent the U.S. Pacific from engaging in the war that the Japanese were planning against Britain, the Netherlands, and the United States of America. At home, this caused production to rapidly increase. This dramatic increase pulled America out of the Great Depression. While men were being drafted into the armed services, women were taking up their responsibilities in the labor force. To promote the idea of women workers, the Rosie the Riveter was created. This fictional character stirred up patriotic feelings, causing more women to join the war efforts. As America began fighting, well over 12 million women had entered the workforce. In order to work, most women had to give up school or being a stay-at-home mom. However, many women felt the sacrifices were worthwhile in order to help their nation. Most felt that this war was their patriotic duty.
We had to do riveting and drilling, and you had to inspect. You had to be jack of all trades in the department I worked in, because the spar was about 15 feet long and about 2 feet wide, And somebody had to help lift them on and off, and then you had to have somebody in front of it and back of it and inspect the tube.
On the holidays, we worked. Everybody worked at 7-7, 24 hours. I worked from 2 to 10. We had 6 weeks training that we had to learn how to use the guns and the bucking bars and the rivets, how we had to put them in. So we had 6 weeks training for that. And after the training, I worked from 6 in the morning till 2 in the afternoon. And then we switched from 2 in the afternoon to 10 o'clock at night. And that's the shifts I worked.
There were about four worked on one plant thing. Maybe it'd be two here and two here. And then we trade off. You hold that big old heavy riveting bar. My hands are paying for it today. They said that's what caused it. So that's why I said it was too hard a work for women to be doing, really.
The Sun River, at that time, we were making masks for the servicemen, and I was stringing straps for the masks, and I worked there for a while, and then I was transferred into the press room, which I was running a guillotine cutter, which is a cutter that's probably 20 feet long, and it had a large blade in the center, and I was running stock for Firestone parts on this guillotine cutter.
More than 6 million female workers helped to build planes, bombs, and other weapons that would lead to a U.S. victory in World War II.
All the new people that came in, the older people paid jokes on them. And we had a tool bin, but we had to go get tools. They told me one day to go get some prop wash. Well, I didn't know any better. I went over and asked for some prop wash. Well, I found out it was what prop wash was then. So everybody was laughing then. They thought that was funny because that was a joke that they... You know what prop wash is? Well, it's the air behind the plane.
I was finally asked to be an inspector for these tanks that were repaired. So I was called to the repair department to inspect a tank. Well, I didn't know it, but there was somebody inside, and they had their black cement on top of the tank. And pretty soon, the girl inside was singing, and she just went like this to the tank, and that whole all that black cement went over my face. So they had to take me to the restroom and take it off with, I think they used gasoline after they wiped off as much as they could. But it was kind of a standing joke for a long time.
In the C-47, it was a transport plane, and we had to take and put little rivets in the plane and then shoot it with an air gun. And somebody behind the rivets had to hold like a bucking bar. And the bucking bar went behind as you shoot it in. And we had to wear our pictures and our department number that we was in. And everybody got along with everybody real good, but it was like, you hope that the planes all get over there safe and sound and that everything would be okay.
When World War II started, Goodyear Aerospace Corporation was a builder of blimps and zeppelins. By the time the war had ended, however, the firm was also known as the builder of the FG-1 and the FG-2 Navy Corsair, the workhorse of the Navy's air arm in the South Pacific. Not only did the Rosie the Riveters produce things such as tank tread, gas masks, and the like for the war effort, but between 1941 and 1945, they produced 4,008 of these carrier-based fighter bombers. Whoa!
all right. Bet your life he's the king of that fife. It's Piccolo, Piccolo, Pete.
January 24th, 1942. To the employees of Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company, Akron, Ohio. The Army is calling on you, soldiers of production, to back up our soldiers in the front lines with every ounce of your energy. The Army looks to you to provide the weapons of victory. The fighting weapons we lacked yesterday at Wake and Manila, we must have today. Your contribution must be production and more production. America is confident of your answer. Patterson, Undersecretary of War.
And we were there when Akron was flooded. I can't remember what year that was, but it was the one year that I was working, I know, and they had to evacuate the entire plant. And it was, the hill was up above the factory, and the cars were all parked up there, and half the plant was standing out in the rain waiting for their rides to come down, pick them up, to get them into Akron and get away from there. But we went to work the next day just as if nothing had happened. Once in a while we had people coming in that we were working one day and they said he was up on the balcony. And I said, so what, he'll never come down here in the plant. We all kept right on working. And I was inspecting and I had inspected with my fingers, I guess like this, and gone like this and smeared my forehead up with dirt. And when he got down there, he looked at me and put his finger over my forehead and said, your face is dirty. When I tell anybody that, they say, well, that's all he said. Yep, that's all he said. But he was in his Army uniform, so he was there on business, I guess.
It was dangerous where there were a lot of fumes. As a matter of fact, one girl got her hair caught in the buffer. Fortunately, the manager was there and he unplugged the electricity, so she got out of that. Another incident then, a 16, 17-year-old boy didn't come to work one day. He was out having a good time and he didn't get in till late. So he didn't come to work. So two managers got in their car and went and got him at his home and brought him to work. And if we didn't go to work, we better have a good reason why we were not on duty.
I think some of the younger women, like me being 18, starting so early, working 8 hours a day, every day, 6 days a week, you know, was too much. And when I got sick, I just fell over backwards into a faint, and we never did know why. I think I was just exhausted. Everyone seemed to get along very well, except none of us liked wearing bandanas over our heads all the time.
Food stamps were so hard to come by, and I used them very rarely. I was by myself, but it seemed like for meat, I always was a hot dog eater. So there was a little grocery store just around the corner from where I lived on the north end of Barberton, and it was called Owens. And so I started getting hot dogs every day. And every time I would walk into Mr. Owens' store, as soon as I'd walk in the door, it didn't matter who was in the store, Mr. Owens would say, Mary, how many hot dogs you want today? And it got to be a real joke because everybody laughed about it because he knew that I came in for hot dogs every day.
Plenty, got a lock on the door. afraid somebody's a-going to rob them while they's out a-making more. What more?
I had this, I think it was a 1940 Chevy. It was one of the last cars that was made, really. And so we decided, this other couple decided to take their niece up to see her husband that was graduating or leaving the boot camp. So we decided to drive my car up there. Okay, we had enough gas to get up there and enough gas to get back. I got to like about a block from home and I ran out of gas. And I didn't have any more ration coupons. Well, I just left the car sit until my father-in-law could bring me a gallon of gas to drive it home.
When the war ended, it was eerie because I was one of the last ones to leave the department. And it was just like, okay, last one out, turn out the lights. That's about the way it was.
They had built another one of these big platers in Miller Rubber Company, which was then part of Goodrich, was across from Firestone. And so I was the evening shift technical personnel. I was the only one technical personnel on the evening shift. So I did all the tests and I okayed all the stuff and that kind of thing. When that plater was turned off, the day the war was over, I turned it off. It was never turned on again. So that was the end of my Rosie the Riveter type of experience.
It was kind of a good time, but still, after years went by, we realized that we were a part of the victory in World War II.
My memories are as clear as if it was yesterday. I mean, it's still with me.
Our country, and you have to do what you can to help it.
We were very young, you know, and didn't realize really what was going on sometime. But now, when we think about it, we were a big part of our World War II effort.
You did what you needed to do. That was what you did. I mean, you were an American. The job was there, and you did it. Pride doesn't really enter into it exactly. Pride of with my country and the fact that we did do what we did, but everybody was doing it. It's not something that I, as an individual, was exceptional in any way. We were attacked. I mean, I don't think anyone had any feelings other than, well, we gotta go over there and do what we have to do now, and we gotta do it right, and we're gonna win. Nobody ever doubted that we would win whatever it was we were doing.
Everything seems just like one of my dreams. Wake me up and say it's true. I wouldn't be dreaming, I wouldn't be scheming if I had a boy.